Younger first pick, Batrider, Elder Titan in response, and then Murata, of course, a flavor hero that's been around for a while now with the Axe Scepter. Still strong despite the nerf. We see her here. So, bans, what about the bans? Faceless Void, Shadow Demon, Axe, and then Drow Ranger, Oracle, and Juggernaut. Anything standing out to you there?
The first four are very, very obvious, especially with the fact that Team Alternate wanted to go for a first pick Batrider. Banning out SD is one of the better heroes to deal with that lasso. There's also, excuse me, there's also like Venge that you could maybe think about banning out, but they didn't. They actually banned out Axe. Axe is just an overall strong hero. That tells me they maybe want some kind of like melee carry. It's really good against like your Juggernauts, which actually was banned out by Brood, so maybe they were thinking, oh, you ban Axe, we'll ban Jug. So, yeah. And then Sand King has just gained so much popularity. It gained a lot of popularity at TI. It's gaining momentum and popularity right now. It's kind of interesting because right now is the period where I think teams understand the meta and the patch the best because they already saw what worked and what didn't at TI. Now, there isn't as much as on the line, isn't as much on stake or at stake, but I think now is when teams start to understand everything a lot more until the next patch comes along. Morphling now banned out for Broodmothers. Just a general strong carry hero. That seems to be really popular right now.
Also, the Axe ban real quickly on that, too. It could be a little bit of reaction because Broodmothers did play Axe last game, and oh, my God, dominated
oh, did they?
With it. Yes, Relax over here played it for them, and, yeah, he just kind of snowballed. So maybe some reaction there. Centaur Warrunner picked up as their third. What's the deal with Centaur? Is that more of a four role or what?
No, it's typically offlane, and right now with Bat, being picked, it's probably going to be offlane with a Bat mid. And it's just, it's another hero that's kind of slowly gaining momentum and popularity. Very, very tanky, hard to kill. The ult is always useful in certain scenarios. It's not the best ult against Kunkka because X can't really ult away from the X combo. So that's a little bit curious to me. That's the only issue I have with Centaur being picked up right now.
Third pick for the Radiant here. Again, they got the strong combo of the Kunkka Murana. Looking to follow it up. Still could use their core, you'd figure, at least, as well as the true support. So the 1 in 5, I guess, as we label it here. Yeah, the other thing, Elder Titan, he has this natural order ability. It's like that seems like it's a really strong ability, right? Is that an ability that you almost like draft around now that he's there? Is there something that's coming to mind there?
You kind of, well, yeah, you can draft around it like a but one of the only heroes that comes to mind is like a Dragon Knight, but Dragon Knight's hardly ever picked. He has an innate, really strong armor gain. Just this one of his skills just gives him, I think, like 12 armor for free.
Okay.
So that's one.
Like a Sven, maybe?
What's that?
Sven?
Sven could work. But, yeah, you would have to pick up a BKB because they're your melee hero. So
yeah.
Slark is actually quite good against Elder Titan because you don't have to worry about getting stomp locked down. Slark is good against Batrider. You can dark pact the stacks of the Napalm. You can dark pact the Lasso. It's good against Elder Titan because you can just bum rush him and not have to worry about getting stomped. The stomp is a really annoying ability, not just to keep people in place, but to stop a carry heroes from like just bum rushing him. But Slark doesn't have to worry about that. So I actually really like the Slark pickup here for Broodmothers.
Then what do we have? The Phoenix here on the side of ATN as, ooh, Darkseer. Then coming out with that fourth pick for the Broodmothers as well. So, but Phoenix, is that a one roll? Or not a one roll, a five roll probably?
Yeah, probably. So it looks like Phoenix and ET as their support combo, which is a little interesting because typically Phoenix does use a little bit of farm. And against a Darkseer, they're going to need a strong carry that can kind of handle Darkseer without the aid of Phoenix Elder Titan, because they don't really do much to actually pressure him out effectively. So they ban out Ricky, which is a good ban. Ricky Darkseer, I had to play against that combo the other day. Not fun. Not fun at all.
I know.
I was actually thinking Huskar because it deals really, really well with the Darkseer. So nice ban out there from Broodmothers.
Yeah. Takes that option away. Now they're going to figure out their last pick as obviously that time getting low now for them here. But they need what? Their support, right? Yeah, their five rolls. So
10 seconds remaining.
So what is left? Well, Keeper of the Light is what they'll go with
Dire team pick.
As their choice.
overall really good. It's good against the laning stage against Centaur. The off lane is going to be... I don't think you can lane in the off lane if you're Team Alternate, or if you're playing that Centaur, assuming he does go the off lane. You have the mana leak to deal with, which keeps you in place. You have the X that brings you back, and you have a pounce that's going to keep you in place for a long time and do damage. That's just a nightmare of a safe lane, and they don't have... I don't think they have the tools to combat it or go kind of like a dual lane off lane either. I think they just get crushed. So I think if you're the Centaur, you just buy an Iron Talon and go jungle. And this needs to be like a stronger ranged tier that can deal with Darkseer, or they just go like an anti-mage, which can also deal with the Darkseer. It's also very good against Darkseer late game too, because Darkseer has a huge mana pool, but then they got lots of melee. I don't know. It's kind of a sticky situation here for Team Alternate.
Yeah. You know, I was talking about this the other day. Yesterday, actually, I had somebody else on co-casting, and one of the frustrating things actually about this draft UI is there's no way to access the hero pool. I really wish there
yes.
was.
Yes. Oh, you yes. Because when you draw a blank, you're like, yeah. What are the heroes?
I'm like, trying to think here. It's like, well, I guess I could pull it up on my other screen, but yeah.
Or
so.
You'd be caveman like me and not have another screen.
Oh, my gosh. You're one of those guys?
No two screens in 2016.
That is ridiculous. How do you live on the computer? That's oh my god.
I just don't have room on my desk. That's the issue. I need to clean it up or something.
Then you make room. Then you make room. Okay.
Oh god, it's a Viper.
Well, it's a range.
It is a range, and it's a hero that's gonna do really well in the safe lane. But man, they have no carry. So, I mean, Viper's like, let's consider him like a 0.5 carry.
Okay.
He moves very, very slowly, doesn't farm fast at all. They want to end this game, by 25 minutes.
Really? So, okay.
Yeah, they will not out-carry a Morana Slark with a Keeper light on their team. So, they're looking to get, a mech on Viper, a blink on Bat, and just go. We'll see, though. It's hard to kind of push quickly against the high ground defense of Keeper of the Light and Kunkka. Kunkka is so good high ground.
Yeah.
So, we'll see. I definitely favor the Broodmother draft.
It feels like that when it comes to initiation, they're really relying on that. The group up team fight initiation is very strong here on ATN side, but as you put it, it's really that 25, 30-minute mark, and then it's going to just start really going in favor of Broodmothers, if it isn't already at that time. So. This is something that I noticed as a trend, at least for most teams, the port right away and then getting the vision down ASAP here.
Yeah.
Is that pretty typical? You would say probably see that every game, even?
It started happening about 2 months ago, I'd say, right before TEI, people were doing that a lot more. It's because I think teams just realized that TP scroll costs nothing. 50 gold is very expendable. And to use a little bit of extra gold just to get some better vision that probably won't get countered is a bit more important.
Yeah. Oh, well, there's the counter. As you mentioned that. I don't think Batrider ported down here, to be fair, to get that. So, but the ward is still countered.
Well, if he didn't port, then that would make sense why they knew the ward was there, because their ward came down very, very quickly. And that's the reason why you port and put the ward like that, so good you point. Can have a little bit of an edge, but... Yeah, good start here for the Radiant team.
Yeah, BM, again, they dominated in game number one and already off to the strong start here in game two. So ATN definitely has their work cut out for them. As I mentioned earlier, too, ATN also coming off they played Vega Squadron just before this and lost that series 2-0 as well. So rough day for them so far.
Vega's a good team, though.
Yeah, they are.
I've never heard of these two teams, and Vega's a very good team, so... That's understandable. Yeah. And it's actually going to be a mid Viper. So, all the same roles are playing cores, but it's just going to be a farming Centaur up in the safe lane.
So, yeah, you went with the possibility of maybe just giving up the off lane, but they are going to send the Batrider down here.
Definitely can lane a lot better than the Centaur.
Okay.
Definitely laning a lot better. Still could have a hard time, though, once, Kunkka gets level 2. They really need to make sure that this creep equilibrium. Oh, mid lane. Wow.
Yeah, he got really low. That started with the Echo Stomp from Elder Titan. Actually landed right there and almost got a kill out of it, but ends up leaping away, so.
He was able to save his salve, though. That's really important. If he had, got panicked and used the salve in the middle of all that, his lane is completely lost, so. I mean, it's already very, very difficult to solo against the Vipers. You can just see, how much pressure he can put on. And then ET just suicides himself.
I've noticed that as well several times. Like, that's a thing, apparently, where you'll see the supports or whatever do that. And I guess, you don't lose gold, I guess, or they spend their gold beforehand.
Right.
Okay.
And even if you don't spend your gold, you don't lose very much at all. So, but yeah, of course, typically you want to spend all that gold.
Okay.
And it's really good with heroes like Skywrath Mage. You'll see that a lot, especially in pubs. Are you familiar with that hero at all?
Somewhat, yeah, a little bit.
Just a nuker. Just spams a nuke over and over. Very low cooldown. And you harass your mid, you expend all of your mana, and then go suicide and just do it again. It's very, very obnoxious, but very effective.
All right, that's an interesting idea. That's promoting to play a hero that way. Do everything, kill yourself, do it again. But hey, I guess if it works.
The nice thing, too, is they changed, like, when you used to suicide, it counted as a kill for the other team. And it would kind of look like a game was swayed in one... Whoa, Pink is very aggressive here, just walking up to the tower and stomping. Yeah, unfortunately, the arrow misses, but it had that hit. I think he might have actually died. Very interesting play coming up from the ult. And he gets a regen for his troubles.
Maybe that's why he did that, because he figured why not just go pick up the regen that's still there. I don't know if he died
before he got that regen, it wouldn't have mattered.
That wouldn't have worked, good point. Oh, Torrent's going to miss right there, but... Viper going to apply the auto attacks and harassment in return. But yeah, Elder Titan seems like he's not afraid to just run up and use that Echo Stomp. Oh, bottom lane, actually. Batrider, he's in trouble. He's got a lot of charges on. Multiple heroes with that flight right there, and he will be able to make the escape, actually. So, good play by Nisha there. Actually,
he had a lot of stacks there on all those creeps, but the level 1 Firefly, you see, even with all those stacks, doesn't do any damage. I don't think he got very many of those creep kills. He's only got 3 in total. Leaps out. He actually still gets stunned. Kunkka taking a lot of damage from these right clicks. Actually, that one missed uphill.
One more attack. Oh my gosh, it's not enough, though.
A little bit of HP, but Super still maintains the vision in the mid lane.
There's the first blood. And that's a big deal, right? Like, ATN with this lineup, they really needed that first blood and to get that kind of snowball, as I say, going for them now with the lineup that they have, especially. So.
Yes.
Big start.
Yeah, they absolutely need it. If they are able to get up their items really, really quickly, Slark can't defend. That's one of the problems of Slark, is that he can't defend, like, 5-man pushes at all. One of the best ways to play Slark is to kind of pick people apart, pick them when they're separated, but obviously when they're grouped up, you can't do that, so.
So you mentioned the Darkseer kind of in that draft quite a bit as far as having to deal with him. Well, what do you mean by deal with him? What does he bring to the table that's still, like, annoying?
Well, once you get up to, like, level 2, or maybe even level 3, you can't stop him from farming. He just Ion Shells the Creep Wave, and it's almost impossible to stop his momentum. But if you, quote, deal with him, what I mean is, like, you stop him from ever even doing that and force him to go to the jungle. But that's all off the table now, because now he's kind of doing whatever he wants. But that's because ATN let him. Like, they didn't try to put any heroes to stop him up here. They just put Centaur solo up here to try to do well on his own. And now it's kind of like an even lane, so.
Yeah. All right, well, he's sitting up here at the top lane. He actually has Kunkka coming over even, so. They could possibly even get something out of this if either Phoenix or Centaur go a little too far up. Oh, they're pinging, though. I think they know that he's here now, yeah. He made it pretty obvious. Or somebody's in this area, they're figuring, so. Maybe they didn't actually see him. But if they step into the lane, that could be trouble for them. Bottom lane, okay, just a stack going on here. See the Slark. Probably going to get it seems like the Shadow Blade on Slark is kind of the first core item, makes sense.
Yeah, I would... Like, 9 times out of 10, that's just what all Slarks go. QO from MVP kind of made famous, like, a Blink Dagger build. And I know Loda, actually, when Slark wasn't very popular, would always go Blink as well, so. But the majority of people do like the Shadow Blade better. It gives you a little bit of extra, like, damage and, more importantly, attack speed that Blink just doesn't offer, so.
See, Phoenix is found by both Darkseer and Kunkka roaming through the jungle, kind of stopping the pull that he was doing right there, and getting the experience and farm for themselves, actually. While we're on the topic of, like, who's going to what, you know, Viper mentioned he's playing this middle role. Hinted at maybe something like a mechanism, but is that something you can still see?
I think he should go mech. There's no one else that can really bite on his team. I guess Phoenix could, but it'd be a very, very slow one. And they can't afford to have a slow mech this game. They need those group up and team fight items, and they need them quickly. So I think it should be mech. He could also go for the Dragonlance early on, and then maybe back for a mech after that. Dragonlance is an amazing item for Viper specifically. Gives him the extra attack speed, very, very good stats. And he is absolutely crushing the mid. Of course, he did have help, and it's just a sway to matchup in general. But yeah. This bottom is getting very shut down.
Wow, yeah. 16-0 for that Mirana right there.
It's a 41-25.
Yep. That is domination at its finest. So Slark also having a very good time, though. Of course, understandable, and essentially kind of free farm at the bottom lane, 49-10. And obviously, he's got the early Iron Talons. That's a fairly newer item, right? The Iron Talon?
Yeah. I'd say, like, what, 4 or 5 months? Something like that. Maybe a bit longer. I think it's OP.
Yeah, it seems like I see it every game. That's why I kind of brought that. I didn't really notice it a whole lot before, and all of a sudden I'm seeing, like, every game. So.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. It definitely will be nerfed in the next patch around.
Okay. Vanguard, by the way, finished.
Down one.
Wow. He's going to try to get away with this, using his Q, the Dark Pact right there, trying to escape from the Pat Rider. The Shadow Dance comes out. Elder Titan. He's going to try to hunt him down, though. The Echo Stomp, he guessed. He was unable to hit, though. And the leap away, and I think that means he should be getting away. But back here, actually, Kunkka coming in for the assist, and now he may get turned himself, actually, with Slark and Keeper of the Light running back in. Slark still fairly low, but Elder Titan, not much mana. Phoenix with the Death Ray coming out. I don't even know if that's what it's called, but I'll call it that anyways. The Sun Ray, okay. Slark, he has so little life. So does Batrider, though. They're so almost dead in both cases. And the nuke from Keeper of the Light finally will finish off Phoenix. And that's how it'll end. Only the one kill after all of that. But in favor of BM.
That was a really sloppy fight on both sides, but kudos to Mirana for actually getting the ult at level 6. I see a lot of variance in skill builds for Mirana. I know, for instance, Samael on EG, he refrains from leveling up until like level sometimes like 8 or 9 even. And he actually just goes for the points back into the arrow for extra damage. But I'm a big believer of, especially in mid-Mirana, leveling up that ult just as soon as you can. For that reason, I mean, they would not have won that fight if not for that ulti. It was great for Slark, too, because it triggers his Shadow Dance. So he gets the regen going. So.
Yeah, I got the chance to actually play a game of Slark myself the other day and realize how strong that is. Like, when you're not in combat, that passive kicking in, it's absurd. It's just the reset capability that he has.
Yeah, in fact, when I first started playing Dota from Han, that was one of my favorite heroes to play, and specifically for that ult. I'm like, are you serious? You just get free regen for nothing?
Oh, Elder Titan, can you land this Echo Stomp? It's not going to be easy. Slark, obviously, very, very slippery. Going to run, and he's going to be fine for now. He also does have Coddle coming over for the assistance. So, yeah, he'll be good, but they're starting to apply more and more pressure to the Slark, clearly. Again, they lost the one guy earlier attempting to make a play down here, but I guess that's a good strat. You know, don't let Slark just do his free farm thing. Keep the pressure on. They're kind of going.
Yeah. I think ATN... Unfortunately, though, what they need to do is not really pressure heroes and pressure lanes. I think pressuring heroes will come naturally once you group up and push the lanes together if BM actually decide to fight. But honestly, they really shouldn't be able to fight. The only issue I see here is this Darkseer is getting a lot more farm than I really think he should have. I think they should have put a little bit more pressure in this lane. The other lanes were just going to win naturally, except for Bat. Bat, that was the only lane that would have been a little bit more difficult. But... you know, Bat's very strong and can go in the jungle level 1, so you would have won mid heavily. You would have won top, made that Darkseer, because Darkseer is really the only early team fighting hero that BM have, and he's the one that's also having, you know, one of the best starts.
Oh man, this is a bit of a bait right here. The Echo Stomp goes off though, but Focus is going to be able to Shadow Dance before that and skirt on out of there once again. So again, we have the situation, Batrider and Slark are both low. Slark tries to pounce in to secure a kill, unable to though. The X marks the spot, the Torrent, the Ship, they should get this kill another time. He is tanky, but not tanky enough. Slark gets credit for the last hit right there. So we're 11 minutes into this game, and that's now only the third kill of the game. So a very slow-paced game, actually.
It feels like Han, doesn't it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. A little slow-paced game now.
I remember the benchmark in my head for Han was if we had, one kill per... per minute.
Yeah.
We were good. Now in Dota, you see some games where you have double that, and that's like average.
I will say, after you let, like, Han in the last, like, year and a half, it actually picked up a lot. So.
Of course. I'm giving the game shit. It was just, but, you know, we used to do it with League of Legends all the time, too, right? Remember?
Oh, of course.
We'd be like, two kills in 40 minutes.
No, League is still that for sure. Yeah, the League's just like.
Is it really?
I believe so. I don't know. I don't really watch it. I think so. But yeah, no, what I have been watching a little bit of Dota 2 again, I've noticed that too. It's a lot of action, and maybe not this game specifically, but we got some action here with Viper in the middle lane getting low, but again, the Sunray coming out, and Response trying to help them out. The Echo Stomp from Elder Titan is not going to be enough for any kills, but it will save the Viper there and give him away. So the kills still remain at 3 as we now approach 12 minutes into this game. So, it's not due to lack of action, I guess. It's just they're not fully getting each other killed is what it comes down to.
It's due to the lack of spells actually hitting each other.
Okay.
A lot of missed spells on both sides.
Sloppy play, we'll call it.
But this is all going to favor... Oh, Slark gets off the ulti, but it's not in time. Batrider actually did get the lasso off, and it wasn't dark-facted, so that's a big, big kill, but... If it does kind of go even, I favor BM, obviously, just because they actually have late game, whereas ATN doesn't really. Viper, he did go for the Dragonlance first, as I alluded to. Overall, great item. Still would love to see the mech. Blink now picked up on Bat, so despite the laning situation that he had to deal with in the bottom lane, he's actually got some good farm. So this is a very, very strong power spike here for ATN. And... Let's hope for their sake they're able to take down some towers because there's still all of them remaining here for Broodmothers.
Now, somebody we really haven't referenced a lot of this game, and for good reason, because he's literally been like AFK at this top, is this Centaur Warrior, Warrunner, excuse me.
Yeah.
Hood of Defiance now to go to Vanguard. I mean, he is tanky.
Yeah. Yeah, he's really, really tanky, and he hasn't even gone for the blink yet between all these items. Very interesting that he actually picks up full treads, too. I've never seen that. Usually it's like Tranquil's 90% of the time.
Maybe.
So yeah, that's just, yeah. He just wants to go all tank, and I don't blame him. He can be your front runner. They can't really kill him. If they spend all their spells doing so, then that frees up a little bit more time for the Viper. And then Elder Titan's got good levels, so it's actually not looking too bad for ATN. Again, it's still kind of scary because they have. Very poor late game, but this is a very, very strong time for them. I still think you go for Blink. I mean, it's kind of hard to pass up Blink now for Centaur. Maybe he goes for Pipe before that, but the Blink tool is... Oh, he actually went all points into Return. I've never seen that either.
Oh, that's the counterattack ability? Yeah.
Yeah.
Only one level in a stomp. Interesting.
It's just not a very good... valuable. Oh, they're actually going to try to go on him, despite him being so tanky.
There's a Stampede use right there, but he gets thrown up in the air. How tanky is he, though? We're going to find out right here. Elder Titan, the Echo Stomp, actually does catch Darks here, but he pulls him out with the vacuum. Into the wall. Out comes the Sunray. Nobody dead just yet. That's been the name of the game. Finally, Darks here will fall down. Keep it the light nuke from the background, but couldn't be enough. Well, we saw a bit of the tank right there, as well as the support obviously coming in when they did. Well played there, actually, from ATN.
See, I don't know how to feel about that. It's like, Focus is going to try to go for a kill on the Batrider. Doesn't have enough damage. I don't know if he does. Trying to run away. He doesn't have Firefly up. He can get rid of one of those sticky napalms. He actually does get the kill. Nicely played there by Focus. Good patience there. But before that, it's like, okay, we saw his items. We saw he had Treads, Vanguard, Hood, and we still decided to make the conscious choice to go on him. So it's like, is it really great item decision by Centaur, or is it more of... What were you thinking, Broodmothers, going on by far the most tanky guy in front of his tower when we knew that people could TP?
Yeah, you kind of wonder. It's one of those cases, did they actually check his inventory beforehand? Because he is a tank, especially at this point of the game, and that's a really good point to make right there. So perhaps a misplay from BM, we could chalk it up to that. Maybe a little overconfidence, especially after the first game. Stomp by them, but ATN will take it. As again, you look at the graphs, actually. ATN has a fairly comfortable lead on both net worth and experience.
Yeah.
16 minutes almost into this game. So they definitely have a lot of good reasons to feel good right now. As Forest Staff is in Viper, so he's going to finish. What does that make again? The Dragonlance and Forest Staff? The
Hurricane Pike.
Hurricane Pike, yes. I've heard that that's actually a pretty good item. So
Yeah, it's good because Dragonlance is good, Force Staff is good, and then putting them together, you actually get extra stats. So
and increased range, right?
Yeah. Does it increase the range too? It might.
Oh, but there's a pipe breaking out. We'll find that in a second. But actually, Kunkka going to get pulled in. The Echo Stomp to secure it. That was the initiation, though, from Nisha, who does have that Blink Dagger, and you see the power of that with the Batrider, of course.
Yeah. So what I mean is, like just putting two items together actually buffs up your stats, too. So the Dragon Lance is 14 strength, 14 agility, but then when you put it together, just by putting it together, you get an extra, like, 6 agility for nothing.
Okay.
And then one more strength, which is not that much, but I always like items that just gives you extra stats that you don't really... that aren't found in the components. Another example of that is the upgraded Shadow Blade to Silver Edge. Just by putting it together, you get like an extra 5 stats to everything.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, that's always kind of a big thing for me. I like items like that.
Yeah, increases attack range of ranged heroes by 140 as well, so... You see Viper, how far back he is right there, just pounding into the tower, gonna eventually take it out. As the bottom push is successful, so now this is the point where we see the objectives kicking in pretty well for ATN. They get 2 tower kills right there. You do see the top lane. BM is actually trying to do some pushing themselves into the secondary, but that was also one of the strengths we talked about for ATN, at least from the beginning, is their initiation is very strong, so it does feel like right now BM is somewhat trying to avoid outright team fights, if anything with the lesson they learned earlier, trying to jump the centaur at the top lane, but for now they are escaping.
And he shows no signs of going for the Blink Dagger. He's going to go for straight heart.
Hey, when they come to you, why do you need Blink?
Exactly. And that is congruent with his skill build, too, because as I was going to say before he got initiated on, there's not really too much of a point to go for return early on, because the strength bonus damage is a percentage, and you don't have that much strength early on in the game. Now, he does have an extremely high strength game, but it's more beneficial towards the later stages of the game. But hell, if he's just going for this huge strength item build, then maybe it does work. Yeah. Although it doesn't really matter now, because now he's going to have full skills of everything, but I digress.
Oh, God, he is massive right here. He's going to get nuked by Keeper, but that's just going to show him that Keeper's there. That was a risky play by Keeper. Oh, my gosh. I thought for sure that stomp was going off and he was dying right there, but he does get away. Slark got picked off middle lane meantime. All right, that was, looks like Batrider initiation. Once again. That lasso. I thought you said it's supposed to be a counter to Batrider.
It is. But he's just, they're able to either A, most of the time what I've been seeing is he's actually getting stomped, and he's not dark factoring the stomp. So it's kind of like, do I dark pack the stomp and make it so I'm not, sitting there for 4 seconds and I can move freely? But then, hey, if I do that, then it opens me up. They've clearly seen I've dark packed it, then they can go for an opening for the Batrider lasso. So what I've been seeing is him not using the dark pack for the stomp, and then you're like, okay, he didn't use dark pack, I can just go lasso. So it's kind of a weird situation for him. Also, maybe he's getting initiated from fog and he can't see them.
Yeah.
And that could be happening too. Either way, they're doing a good job.
Mana leak on the centaur. Okay, here we go.
He has the heart.
They're going
he's
again.
He's not dying.
He has the heart, as you mentioned. So good luck killing him. Meanwhile, the back on they do jump Elder Titan. A little bit easier, perhaps. Vacuum pulls him in. They do kill the Elder Titan. However, meanwhile, back here, no, they're not initiating back in the background. Slark will pounce away. Not everyone's here, actually. That's another Torrent hit. So you do see way over here. Mirana's over here, as well as Batrider. So. Involving everyone. Centaur, though, he still wants to chase, again, for good reason. He is, as you mentioned, not going to be killed, so he might as well. But he won't be able to chase successfully. Over here, though, what is Viper doing? He's running into a trap, actually. He uses that. The
That's
pike,
a gem down.
But
That's
he goes
a gem down.
Down,
too.
And the gem is, they got it? Or? It's picked up by Slark, yeah.
Yeah, that's a really, really big swing of net worth right there. And also, as the game progresses, if Slark buys a BKB, that is one way to combat this huge strength build of Centaur Warrunner, because you're going to drain those stats really, really quickly, and with a BKB, you don't have to worry about getting gone on or anything like that. Yeah, you can still get lassoed, but you really don't want to lasso a BKB Slark. It's just not going to kill him. So we'll see if that's the item build he goes for. I really think he needs it. But very, very good fight here for Broodmothers.
Yeah, the Echo Saber on him, and that's definitely one of these fights on this game. The way it's been going, that's got to feel pretty good for BM here. Another item did I see picked up, actually? Yeah, it might have been the four staff. Yeah, I think it was the four staff on Batrider here, but just some more initiation and wait to close the gap when it comes to initiating here. We're circling the Radiant Jungle for some reason. Not sure what that's about.
That's saying we have no vision here.
Oh.
I do that too.
Okay.
We got no wards.
Yep. Yeah, I'm looking at the vision right now for them, and yeah, it is lacking big time, actually, for the Radiant side especially.
Yeah, well, they do have a gem now, so they can de-ward, and it makes it easier to ward a little bit. But, oh, they just placed a ward. He's like, give me wards, give me vision. He's like, okay, and then he gets countered right away. So.
Yep, that's not fun. Oh, ping's on a Roshan, so here we go with Roshan now for the first time this game. Attempt that here. You see a Viper leading the way. I would figure that, they can definitely see this, actually. They're in the area. They can't actually see the Roshan pit itself, but...
Correct. But they can see other heroes kind of, you know, hovering around, and they should have an idea here pretty quickly. Keeper of the Lights doing some interesting things. I thought he was warding, but he has no wards, so... How did he get up here?
I think he was running away from them initially, and he's like, it's one of those awkward situations. He's like, okay, now I'm kind of trapped.
Yeah.
He's just going to kind of run on by. Okay.
He's going to recon somebody?
Well,
they know where he is, sort of, now. But their initiation bat is down to the bottom lane, so... It looks like this is going to be a free one.
You get us to Viper, of course.
I think so, yeah.
There we go. And now, Keeper, you gotta run. If you stick around, you're probably gonna be killed. They do take the secondary tower. No, they're trying to kill it, actually. Now Port's coming in, so they might not even get this. That's a Centaur, of course, and you gotta run away from that, as we've seen. And that they will. So the secondary tower will stay alive, actually. Here at the top lane. Well played by the part of ATN, not only getting Roshan, but protecting their objective.
Still not going for the blink here for Centaur. Very interesting.
I mean, yeah, they don't, like, it's not like Elder Titan has, yeah, their initiation does seem, obviously they got Batrider, so maybe that's just their thing. It's like, we got the Batrider initiation, do we really need another one on top of that, but.
I feel like you do, and the reason is you have a Viper. Viper has no initiation whatsoever. He is the king of, I hope you run at me, heroes, because, yeah, you have your slows, but, and that's why Hurricane Pike is actually so good, because of the, just the added range and whatnot. But you still have the innate problem that you can't really catch anybody.
Oh,
it's actually an ult back.
Speaking of catch, yeah, they catch Slark back here. The Sun Raid is pounding into him the whole time, and he is dead. Is there any buyback? No, he doesn't have a buyback. They're going to be without Slark for the next 55 seconds here.
Oh, man. And they have the Aegis. That was a big, big pickoff here.
My question is, what was he even doing there? And
he was probably trying to cut the wave.
Okay.
So cut the wave so they can't push anymore, as long as his team kills the remaining wave, but that was a very risky play, and good job by Batrider, but by sniping that one out.
Yeah.
Okay, one thing about this build that really works for Centaur is look at how much damage you do to buildings.
Actually, ship coming out right there. Hits a couple, but not really going to follow it. Why is that the double edge? Can you use that on buildings?
Your return works on buildings. So
when
they attack you, it does a lot of damage back to the building.
Huh. That's actually really nice, yeah. Based on the strength there. Oh, the Rax. It's a drop in. There's the invulnerability. 3 seconds left on Slark, so he will be back up. They're going to save the Rax for now. Oh, they're going to pull back in Viper. There's a Torrent. Not the biggest follow-up, though, again.
Here comes Slark. He's trying to go for the back lines, but he doesn't get the Dark Pact off again.
Oh, no. He's in trouble, and he just dies right after. No Dark Pact is mentioned. Can't Shadow Dance either. Darkseer goes down. Mirana's going to get picked off, it looks like. One more auto attack. No, she will barely survive way over there, but the Rax is going to fall as the buyback from Darkseer happens. Meanwhile, Kunkka, they do catch Batrider, so at least something positive coming out of this very negative situation for BM, but that will be the end, it looks like, as the wall is going to chase after them with the illusions once we're finished here. But yeah, the Slark, he's just getting caught without the Dark Pact, I think is kind of the name of the game here.
Yeah, he's not respecting the Batrider lasso, and he's just simply not pressing the ability before it. The gem was... who did it go to? It was on Slark, but he obviously... I think he dropped it before he died earlier. And I have been trouble finding. I've clicked on all the heroes. No gem on the Radiant side. No gem on the Dire side. It must be sitting on the ground somewhere. That's the only thing I can think of.
Can it be destroyed? Oh, it's right here.
Oh, it's in the base. Gotcha. Yeah. Okay. So, I was going to say that would be really bad if ATN had it, but honestly, they don't even need it, it seems like. They're getting killed on Slark without it.
Yeah.
But, yeah, we'll see. Batrider's got a good chunk of change under his belt. 2,700 gold, just about. We can get a Yules. We can get bots. I always liked getting the Aether Lens with Bat, but that's usually kind of a first item before Force Staff, so... Just helps you. The range on the lasso is very, very small. And look at ATN. They're playing this. They're playing their lineup really smartly. Like it was an interesting lineup, but they're playing it how they need to be. How it needs to be played, and just grouping up and pushing. That's now a Lotus Orb here for the Centaur.
I saw that. Yeah, he used it on himself actually. So it's kind of a fun item to see. As up, oh, there we go. Taking off, but he kills the tower with ease. And it's like, what do you do against this? You have a you have an Aegis on the Viper, who now is a PKB, by the way, that she got. Out
Slark,
the ship.
They see Slark again. They see Slark again with the Sentry and Ward down, and he gets caught.
He gets caught yet again. Now, this time he's actually going to live. He doesn't get the Shadow Dance off, so he's going to be fine for now. The ultimate from Ultra Titan also going out right there, but not really hitting anyone. Torrent onto Viper in the background. But Slark's just trying to live this whole time, as is Mirana. Mirana will fall victim. She does buy back immediately. So everyone is up currently. Not the most life, as well as mana for that matter, as the Nether Rax is in trouble. Slark, though, once again caught, this time by the Stomp of Centaur, will barely survive, but they just they can't fight this. I mean, Centaur is just so beefy in the front lines, and then, yeah, getting caught by Batrider. I don't know what more they can do on the side of BM. It just feels like they just have to accept the Centaur Warrunner beating their base and killing it.
Slark had a good idea about going around in the back lines. Oh, that's a wall onto only one hero, unfortunately, and that's the Viper. They can't go on Centaur. They have to go on the people sitting behind him. But the approach that Slark had was just not working because they had vision of him, and he's not pressing the dark back before the lasso. Lasso is cooling down 13 more seconds, though, and that's just a dead wreck, so they can't do anything about it.
All right, well, there's that. You got the middle, obviously, with the melee racks going down, so... BM, of course, not going to be throwing any GGs out yet, but they are behind him. It's only a 9-6 hero kill lead, but that's,
jeez, yeah,
that's nothing compared to where this game's actually at. It's ridiculous. I mean, the net worth and the experience are to definitely give a better story about how things are looking in this game, but it is well in favor of ATN now, and you just see more and more items constantly being purchased too. There's a BKB on Batrider even, just to help his initiation there as well.
Yeah, it's gonna. That's actually really good against Mana League. It's good against the X combo of Kunkka, so he doesn't have to worry about anything. Also, a big thing in that fight is they tried to kill that Phoenix Egg, which was in the middle of all of them, but they weren't able to do so. And now Slark running around, trying to find a pickoff on someone. That courier actually dies, and that's 3,000 gold on that courier.
Oh.
Huh. Jeez, okay. As if they weren't farmed already. ATN could have used 3,000 extra gold, but.
Yeah. Darn. Not the end of the world for them, but still, nice little pickoff there for Radiant. But what is this, by the way, the Lotus Orb pickup on Centaur, I wanted to admit, like, is there a specific ability he's getting that for, you think, or is it just, like, just a hack?
Mana Leak.
Mana
probably.
Leak? Okay.
Yeah, the Mana Leak is the best, is reason enough to just buy the entire item. So typically, you see Caudle against Timbersaw. That's a really, really popular counter against him, but Timbersaws will just go for the Lotus Orb if they do have that against them.
Okay.
One of the best tools against Mana Leak, which is one of the most annoying abilities in the game. Backline. They actually go for a backline fight here.
It almost worked out. Well, it does. They actually do take up the Viper as well as the Phoenix is dead. And my camera's locked right here. Anyways, here we go. The Elder Titan trying to get away. He's trying to go for the port out. He will be successful. Yeah, it's kind of hard to catch that. As actually Centaur Warrunner gets pulled back because of the X marks the spot. But again, just he's so beefy. It's just so difficult to kill him, even though he's by himself. But you figure at the end of this, they should be able to finally, being 1v5 essentially. And he did some damage, but not enough when it was all said and done. So he goes down. Yeah, missed the beginning of that, though, honestly. I don't even know how they really got in there, but somehow, some way, somehow. Gun to the back lines.
They had a Potaman Viz, and they went around them, and that's the approach they've needed to do this entire time. Up until this point, it was Slark by himself going for a single pickoff, and he just got caught every single time. But now they went as a team, and none of them got caught. So As a result, they kill three. And you can see that Slark is very, very good against Centaur if he's isolated. And his farm is very, very low, the Slark is. But if he does get that BKB, he can just bam, bam, wham, bam, thank you, ma'am, on the Centaur all day and just stack up those essence shifts.
Oh, so it has a lot to do with that. Okay.
Yeah.
Essence shift there.
It drains his stats and gives him tons of agility. So as the fight goes on, if he's not dying, you can see Slarks get like plus 150 agility sometimes.
And jeez.
Whereas they're also losing their stats. So it's very, very good item. Or sorry, very good ability in long, drawn-out team fights.
Yeah.
Especially against tanky heroes.
That being Centaur, at least in this game for sure. So, Viper, by the way, has a Hyperstone picked up. Is there an item that's coming to mind for that, you think?
Assault Caress.
Okay.
Yeah, it doesn't look like Centaur... I would say has his item slots, but he does have one more. But yeah, probably is Salt Caress.
Okay, the AC for him, and yeah, that's another thing though. Centaur, what will he get also with perhaps that final item slot?
Apparently not Blink.
No,
so funny to me.
That was, I mean, it's almost like a point where it's like he just won't get it. Like there's no point. If we saw it now, it just seemed like okay, really? Like why didn't you just get that before?
Yeah. He could do a lot of different things. He could upgrade his Vanguard to Crimson Guard. Which he probably should do. He could get the Aghanim Scepter, which makes them all do like 60% less damage. 60% less damage. Or his team takes 60% less damage. He could do that. But, he's going to go for what? Another heart?
Really? He does have another Reaver. Wow.
I mean, Titanic is pretty useless on Centaur, but.
Yeah, I was going to check.
It's probably going to be a heart. But it's actually good against, again, for the return. If he is tanking the damage of those towers, they die super fast.
I guess Roshan kind of, you know, does some damage to himself too. So.
Yeah. Well, yeah, sorry, not even towers, but heroes in general too.
Yep.
But yeah, so 75% of his strength plus a negligible 22 is basically just the percentage. And you're looking at... What, if it was 100, that'd be just 75 damage. It's almost 200, so it's like almost 150 damage per attack, plus the 22, so basically 200 damage that they're taking every time they attack him. And it's physical.
So you're saying it's pretty good.
It's pretty good.
Pretty good for this Centaur here. So even just the Reaper alone, I mean, it's providing plenty without the full heart finish. So they do kill Roshan, as we saw there. So another Aegis, again, onto Viper to deal with. There's a Dagon. Finished on Mirana. Does she have... Okay, she didn't actually get that other item first. Not the Ghost Scepter, but whatever it makes. I saw that before.
Sorry, what?
There's the Ghost... The upgrade of the Ghost Scepter, whatever that makes.
Oh, Aetherblade.
Aetherium Blade, yes, that thing.
Yeah.
What's going on up here? Viper, he got... Okay, actually, they do kill the Phoenix in the background, but now Slark is here by himself. Again, the Shadow Dance is up. He's going to survive for the time being. They get the Elder Titan. Viper respawning right here with the Aegis. But again, the initiation, it's like a whole different team from BM this time around. They finally get them off. And this is back-to-back fights that they're winning. Nisha will fall as well. The Batrider could not get the lasso off at a decent time right there. And now it's just a War Runner yet again. Oh, no, Viper is actually still here, of course. So you see actually... Oh, nope. Darkseer trying to run away, but the dot is a little bit too much. Viper, on the other hand, he will fall to the Slark right here. And I mean, that's it. It's really just the initiation that's being the big key right here in these fights, it feels like. Finally, they're able to get them out in their favor. Now the War Runner's like, all right, I got
Slark.
A lot of life. Jeez. They're going to finally kill him after all this, hopefully. There you go. All right. Well, I'm actually feeling a lot more confident that BM actually has a chance to win this game.
They definitely have a chance. They're taking the fights very, very smartly and just going around in the back lines. The BKB was picked up finally by the Slark, just a paramount item here in this type of game. And he was just able to stand and bang for 10 seconds, and now it's 9. But and now look at how many essence shifts he's up to. He's almost 100 agility stolen. And that carries on with him for like a good minute, I think, or two minutes, 120 seconds.
Jeez.
So.
Yeah, 32 charges of the 96 agility stolen. That is ridiculous, as Silver Edge just mentioned. So, yeah, the potential for, in fact, what do the turrets say? Yeah, wow, the net worth going way back up there and still in ATN's favor, but, and the experience has obviously jumped well ahead for BM on top of that. But yeah, just the feeling of the game as well. It's no doubt much better for BM right now. In fact, they're going to push the secondary tower here middle lane. While this is happening, Darkseer just counter pushing the other lane. Obviously, they're going to have to really focus on that too. That's the downside now. They're trying to make a comeback, and they have both the middle and the bottom set of the racks being destroyed. So you're constantly having to worry about that here.
Yeah.
Situations.
Yeah, you're going to need boots of travel, I think, if you actually want to close out the game for if you're Broodmothers. But you really hate to get boots of travel on Slark early on. You need that attack speed. Of course, Mirana does have it, so she can help push out lanes. There's the Basher there for Slark, just finally adding up in those items and getting that net worth up. He's close to Centaur. And his net worth... Oh,
yeah, there's the catch. The last one on the Keeper of the Light, actually. The Echo Slam in the background. The stomp, that is. They get the kill on the Keeper of the Light as well as Kunkka. Now Slark, though, he's dropping to barely no life. Can he somehow survive? This is Shadow Dance surviving for the time being, but okay, he will pour it out in time before they can ultimately get the kill on him. You see also Mirana going to leap away and successfully make her escape. So, but the two kills taking place. Nice couple of pickoffs there for the Dire. Now they're going to push with it.
It was two supports, and hopefully Kotal doesn't need to respawn here soon. He buys a gem, but okay, there is a buyback here for Kunkka. They do have a glyph, so they're able to defend for a little bit. But watch, I'm curious to see how much damage this tower is going to do to itself here. Just look at that, how fast that dies.
Yeah.
And they don't really want to glyph it either, so... Jeez. Gotta do something now.
Oh, yeah, you can't just give up Mega Creeps here, so you gotta try for something. The Torrent actually just missed on the War Runner now, though. Ship will hit, but he's like, all right, that stung a little bit. Not really. I'm just gonna go back to hitting the racks here. There's the Locust Orb, Lotus Orb on himself. He goes out of Stomp. Slark will finally open. Not gonna go all out here. The Dark Pack, though. The back and back from Darkseer over here, actually. And there's the wallet on top of that. They do get the quick kill onto the Elder Titan. You see Warwinder still sending his ground onto Mirana in the background over here. Viper also putting in the auto attacks, and they should be able to kill her. Yes, they will. So Mirana now dead. Not sure if she has a buyback. Slark will jump in the front guy, though. He's feeling very confident. He's getting great auto attacks on a Viper. Gets the kill onto her. And now Centaur Windrunner. Gonna throw the stomp. Trying to hold his ground, but all he has is a Batrider and a Phoenix Delve. Not the most damage. The Sunray will provide a little bit, but not nearly enough. And Centaur does go down. Batrider will fall as well. And yet again, another hold here for BM. They save the racks. That's the M4. They're going to get a complete cleanup here. What will they do with it? Now's the question.
I'm really curious as to what triggered the Phoenix to press his ult in the back lines. He was ulting, and there was no one near him. Maybe there was like a Potom trying to snipe him out. I know that Potom does have like this kind of snipe out build with the blink, Ags. He actually went for Veil into Dagon now too. So he does have like that one shot potential on the supports, and maybe that's what it was. I didn't quite see. It had to be something that warranted him to push his ult and not hit anybody. So that was like the first start of all these bad things for ATN in that last fight. I think as soon as you respawn, you just go, because they don't have glyph, they don't have a tower. You can just kind of bum rush the racks and maybe get mega creeps. Yeah, you'll all die probably, but I think that's the approach you take. If you keep taking these fights, the Slark is going to get just gargantuan and start 1v5ing your entire team. Now, as BKB charges are getting lower, it's now only 7 seconds, which does make a significant difference, and you can't, you know, sell your BKB and get a new one like you used to be able to, so.
Okay, they did change that, okay.
They did finally change that, yeah.
Alright, so you gotta, you know, definitely be extra careful with the BKB charges there, so that's interesting to know. Yeah, he puts a little bit of pressure on the top base tower, but yeah, it feels like I agree with you. I mean, if they don't kind of just make the point that we have to kill those racks, that's gonna be what it comes down to in the next charge right here. Or else the feedback here of BM is gonna be going back into your own base now and starting to win the game themselves. So they're pushing out the bottom lane down here. See. Coddle's going to throw out the nuke into the creep wave and get it pushed out. What is the appropriate name for that? That would be the Illuminate. All right. Oh, wow. Phoenix actually got picked off at the top lane by Slark. Okay.
Very uncharacteristic and deep ward here from BM, which probably scouted him out. Now, this is going to send a tell to ATN that Slark is nowhere close to the bottom lane, but they do have recall. So he is now bottom lane. Forgot about that.
Yeah.
He does have the Ag Scepter on Coddle.
That would do it. And actually, Slark is going to jump in right here on a Viper. Bash. He's going to go for a port that the bash comes through, so he has to run now. The Elder Tide and the ultimate of his going through as well, trying to assist, maybe scare them off. It's not going to happen, though. Viper goes down. Slark is at that point, it feels like, that he's just becoming unstoppable, and they are feeling it. Lisa will fall on the other Titan as well, the buyback immediately following it. But Viper is currently staying dead for the time being.
He got a dark pact on the lasso.
Did he actually use it right there? Okay.
Finally got it. And boy, was it useful, because he didn't have buyback. He bought something, I think. What is on the courier? It's his, almost his Abyssal Blade.
Oh, wow.
So he wouldn't have had buyback.
Well, he got it off, and so maybe things just turned around here for BM, clearly, as far as their play goes as well. So they do push the last outer tower, actually, on top of that. Slark wants to go back in even. Again, he's still feeling confident. In fact, the X marks the spot, pulls back in the War Runner right here. Out comes the Stomp, though, but the BKB's up, so he doesn't really care. Sunray being used right at all. He just leaps on a Phoenix, though, kills him in basically two shots. Goes back to the War Runner, who, again, is very, very beefy here. But the charges just keep adding up more and more for Slark. But now here comes a Stampede from the War Runner, looking to turn this. Good pushback, though. That might have been a vacuum there. And actually, War Runner, oh, that was a coddle. Anyways, War Runner does get caught here himself. Slark again, more auto attacks. Just a matter of time. Getting pulled every which way as there's a vacuum to even assist with that. War Runner will actually survive, though, in the long run. God, he really is just so tanky.
It's almost like Slark wants him to get that health regen from the heart so he can get more stacks. Like, I'm serious. He's up to 48 stacks right now. The Centaur build, unfortunately, is kind of backfiring on himself, because it's just feeding the essence shift stacking of Slark. And I am really surprised. I feel like he let him live there at the end, but they're gaining confidence. There is no buyback on Slark, so that's one thing you have to be a little bit careful of. There's a TP in here by Centaur. Oh, he could totally kill him if he sees him. Oh, just very, very close there. You should be able to see him now, though. Maybe he's scared that people are behind him, but yeah, Slark probably just wants to get his buyback before he does anything crazy, and then they're in a fine position. Vlad's now picked up for Darkseer. I gotta ask you. Do you know what the 3-2-2 reference is from? I'm sure you've seen it in chat.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've seen it.
It has to do with throw, right?
Yeah. That's all you need to know.
Yeah.
It has to do with throw. There's a double damage now on this Slark, who has tons of agility, which means he's going to proc the damage.
See,
even more
is
because
this,
of space damage.
Is this a 3-2-2 moment, though? I don't know if it is.
I would say in general, because like, what were they down to in net worth? They were down to like 14K.
Yeah.
So that's a pretty big throw. But
if you think of how they got there, you know, we were talking about the throw a little bit from Slark in the first place, because he wasn't using the dark pack at appropriate time.
Counter 3-2-2, eh?
Yeah, the counter 3-2-2. Sure, we'll call it that. But yeah, no, it's obviously been a game where ATN, they had control. Again, the graphs show that, yet it's just kind of slipped away.
You were asking good questions earlier when you were like, is Slark really a counter to Bat? Because, you know, they picked it after Bat was picked, and I was talking how, yes, he is a good counter to Bat, especially in the laning phase, but overall being able to dark pack the lasso. But you saw so many times him getting picked off without being able to dark pack that lasso, and you're like, is this really a counter?
Yeah.
Are you bullshitting me, Trough? But he just simply wasn't getting it off, or Bat was finding good initiations through the fog, so he couldn't even see it coming. Whatever the reason was, he just wasn't getting it off, and finally he actually got it off, and it just nullifies that ulti completely, and if you're able to do that, then Slark just goes crazy. And the cool thing about Slark in long, drawn-out engagements, not just because of the essence shift proccing and giving you more stacks of agility and whatnot, but like you said, like the ulti, just being able to disengage. If you're at low HP, give it like 4 seconds, maybe tops, and you're almost at full HP again. You can just, fight fresh.
Oh, he's going to get some stacks right there. He's reset the stacks of the Essence Ship, so not the most gain just yet. But he's got that Centaur to beat on plenty and keep getting more and more stacks. We're going to see right here the 5,000 plus life Centaur. Might as well just start adding. I mean, that's literally what he's doing, right? He's going in, get the auto attacks off, get more stacks. Knowing that they're not going to kill them, but makes sense there.
He could still get that Crimson Guard, since he's clearly not going for the blink.
Yeah.
Everything else he pretty much needs. He needs that pipe. That Lotus Orb is really good. But yeah, this is... Viper does now have the Salt Caress, so that's all fine and dandy, but this is just how the lineup was the lineups were meant to kind of clash as we approach the late game.
Oh,
Thistle Blade on the bat.
There you go, dropping already very low, and he is dead. Does he have a buyback? Yes, he does. He uses it right away, actually. Meanwhile, under tie-in, the ultimate actually lands pretty well right there. That's some good damage, but not enough as Slark jumps right back in, pops the BKB. And you see the ultimate from Phoenix in the background with the egg coming down as well. But Slark is getting low, actually, finally. Has that Shadow Dance up and is on the run. The regen is kicking in. They are not going to be able to chase him down. So, actually, really only had the one death, I guess. That was the immediate buyback.
And he did. And the buyback was the bat who used the lasso on Slark, and Slark was able to get the Dark Pact off again. So, able to sustain and keep the Aegis, so he's able to fight again with that. He actually goes for the BKB on. So, what did he sell? He sold the pipe. Actually, I don't know if he sold it. Maybe it's in this. No, he did sell it, actually.
All right.
So he wants to be able to be a little bit more mobile and fight to not be stunned so that he can stun. There we go with the mana leak being canceled by the Echo Shell. But yeah, very, very good fight here for Broodmother. Still retaining 16 charges of those Essence Shifts. Which is not bad, an extra 48 agility for him.
Yeah. So I'm up to quite a bit early. Actually, there's a pull on a Kunkka, so I think Batrider is finally at the point of like, you know what? Let's start getting the supporting cast. Clearly, it's not working on to Slark, so. Now they get Kunkka, so that's a start. And I mean, it almost now that they got that kill so easy, it almost makes you surprised that they haven't been doing that earlier and sooner.
Right, yeah.
But
typically that's what happens, is you understand that they have a Slark, and if they do have vision of the bat, it's you don't want to risk going on a Slark unless, again, they don't have vision of you. Or they can set it up like they did before with like a Centaur, or sorry, an Elder Titan Stomp, which I'm so surprised that worked out so many times before. Because, like I said at the beginning, it's such an easy spell to Dark Pact. But yeah, that's typically what you see. It's like, okay, we'll forgo going on Slark right now and go on, like, say, like if they get Darkseer, for instance, that would be amazing. Or if they got the Potom, who doesn't have any Lincolns, that would be amazing. Right. Kunkka's fine too, but not the most important hero on the team right now.
So I mentioned that earlier about, speaking of Mirana, actually, I mentioned the Ethereal Blade. So is that not necessary with the Dagon? I guess he does have the Veil of the Discord. But
Do you have to get it with Dagon? Getting
the Ethereal Blade, yeah.
It's very, very good with Dagon, for sure. Because it's going to pump up that damage by, 40%? Something like that? Yeah, 40%. But he doesn't have to get it with Dagon. Like, he could just... Typically, you don't see the Veil Discord on Mirana. I do see Dagon a lot. So what I would see is Ethblade, Dagon, Blink, and then, like, a Lincolns for last item. He should definitely get Lincolns. Very, very good against the Bat Lasso. And among other things, and just regen and stats. But, yeah, you don't have to get the Ethblade. Or, sorry, you don't have to get Dagon with Ethblade, but... I would say get Ethblade over the Veil and then pick up a Lincolns, but that's a lot of gold, so...
It's still so weird.
Seeing
this hero that, you know, obviously has been around since the early Dota days and is a very iconic hero, it's like... It's just weird seeing it with the Dagon build and, like, the Ag Scepter build. Like, this is not the Mirana that I remember, man.
I know, it was really the Ag's change that did it all. Totally shifted the idea of the hero being towards, like, a spammer and a nuker. Just being able to spam the Starfall all the time.
Yeah.
So, yeah, totally changed. It used to just be, what was the build every single game? It was, like, Phase, Drums, Maelstrom, Manta, like, your typical fighting build. And Han, remember, it was, like, Deso all the time. Treads, Shieldbreaker?
Yes.
Treads, Shieldbreaker every game.
Exactly.
But, although it might have changed after I stopped playing, but,
Yeah,
that Ag's changed everything.
Yeah. Ags, that's one of the other things that I've definitely picked up on coming to Dota 2 as well. Ags is just all over the place, man. Like, that's just another thing you have to learn about every hero, too, now. Just what the Ags does for them.
Right.
It almost seems like every hero has one at this point. Or most do, at least. And it's not even... A lot of them don't even affect the ultimates, necessarily. It's, like, random abilities of theirs, so...
Right. Like Undying's, for example. I just played Undying last night. That actually pumps your Decay, so instead of stealing 4 strength... per hero you hit, it steals 10.
Yeah.
So, in long drawn-out team fights, it's pretty amazing.
Ridiculous. Slark and Centaur going at it. Again, don't expect any kills here, but...
He's just getting Essence Shift proc, so...
Yeah.
Nice little 10 proc right there.
He'll take it. The Echo Saber helping with that. And double damage rune up here, by the way. We'll see if anyone notices that in the near future to maybe pick that up. But instead, they're actually headed towards the middle right here. But the Murana ultimate was used. Keeper of the Light. He is going to get taken out, actually. Nice Echo Stomp right there from the Elder Titan to secure the kill. So, nice pick. Sark was not in the vicinity at the beginning of that. They'll take it, but you can just see the shift of momentum in this game. I mean, it went from being constant push by ATN, not even 15, 10 minutes ago even, to now it's just like they can't even leave their base, it feels like.
Yeah.
So, that's just where they're at.
Yeah, very awkward, difficult spot for them, and this is one of the small risks that you have in taking a Viper. You have extremely strong early game, you have extremely strong laning presence, but his mobility as the game progresses just really gets hindered. And I like his item progressions too. It's not like he's building the wrong items or playing badly or anything like that. It's just the nature of the hero. You know, an interesting thing about that I've always been thinking about Slark lately is Echo Saber, which is so good. He's actually going to go on the Centaur, get some more stacks. We'll see how much damage he can do. There is a Darkseer running up here, surging up to maybe assist.
Oh, he's
stop TP or something.
Yeah, he tried to go out with the boost right there. The boost of travel, and he got stomped or hit by the Basher, actually. So, or the Ethereal Blade, or Abyssal Blade. God, that thing.
Yeah. So he ends up abyssaling himself, but. So one thing, like the Echo Saber gives you like an extra attack. But one thing I've noticed is once the game gets really, really late, and once you get tons of stacks onto your Essence Shift, you're attacking so fast it kind of doesn't really matter anymore to get that extra proc because it's like a natural attack almost. So I've always thought as the game progresses, it's better to just get rid of the Echo Saber and get something else. Of course, he still needs like gold for it, and he's bringing out a full AC on Slark. Interesting. We usually see like a Scotty to give him that slow.
Huh, yeah.
Wants the AC now though, so tons of armor. It's also going to help them push by adding negative armor to the towers and whatnot. So.
Now you got the Elder Titan too, so.
That's right. That's mechanism. There you go, Breaky.
I'm learning.
Better point than I made. Better point than I made.
I'm learning. Yeah, no, that's. I was going to say too, it feels like he's, for how this game's been going really and how Slark's been farming so much, it feels like the inventory was a little empty almost, but yeah, the Assault Curious kind of changes that now. He's not like full go. Oh, there's the pull. Did he get the Dark Pack? He did it this time, actually. They didn't catch him before. Will it be enough damage? Yes, it will. It is enough damage. Holy crap, you just see again. That's we saw that 20 minutes ago. It's been a while since we've seen that, but they finally get it to work again. And now he's dead for another 88 seconds. He does not have a buyback.
Right. If they notice, too, that he bought a full AC, they could gamble a bit and say, hey, he just bought a full AC. We need to go down a lane, and we need to go down now. This might be our only opening this game. We'll see how fast they can actually push as the lanes were decently pushed in favor of Brewmothers. Of course, they don't even have the super creeps or whatever they're actually called. I always screw it up. Melee, what
Mega
are they
creeps,
called?
Are they?
Super melee creeps. So they're called super creeps.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Wait, but, so when all the racks are down?
When all the racks are down, they're mega creeps.
Okay.
And now they're super. So they're
right
just buffed
they're
up a little
super.
Bit.
Super. All right. Super almost sounds better than mega.
I know. That's why it was always confusing to me. But now when you think about it, what's better, super or mega? Like, if I was like, yo, dude, I'm super rich. Or if I was like, I'm mega rich.
If you said you're mega rich, I think you're a douche anyways. So.
I know.
Super rich.
Well, I think if you're saying if you're rich at all, you're a douche.
Yeah,
but
that's true. Mega's a little douchier.
Yeah, I agree.
You can just tell after that kill especially, too. So they're not capitalizing here necessarily in terms of counter-pushing into the base, but, I mean, they're able to get some more farm now. And, yeah, what that really translates into, it's hard to say. I guess Viper still has another slot for it. Actually, not here. They catch Murana. She was trying to be a little slippery down here as pushing in the lane. But nice kill, and does she have a buyback? She does.
She does, and she... She really needs to get a Lincoln Sphere. Oh, Roshan is up, so they will definitely take that. Viper has more than enough item slots to take it, as well as enough gold for, like a new item.
On Viper? Yeah. Yeah, that's what I was kind of just getting at, too. It seems like he has at least one more spot in this inventory, so.
Yeah. Butterfly is always great on him. Manta is good. I would like the Butterfly, but... because there is no MKB here for Slark.
Yeah, that feels like it would be actually pretty good, for sure.
That evasion. The only other thing about that is that you're dealing with lots of magic damage, so Moran doesn't care about your evasion, but Viper has a BKB, so that's an answer to that. I really think if you hit with this Aegis, you sell that at Ring of Aquila, and yeah, he actually sells it, and yep, it is going to be the Butterfly, I think. You just need to buy your items, and this is your chance to go. You have Aegis. You need to. The lanes are already going to naturally push themselves out because of the super creeps. This is like their one chance.
All right. Well,
it's funny I'm saying that because they're the ones with a huge racks advantage. But
yeah. I mean, they're the ones, yeah, with the two sets of racks being down. Their base is actually still all good to go. They haven't even lost a base tower yet, but it really feels like BMs is the one in the lead. I mean, the graph does suggest that, to be fair, but here we go, kinda. I mean, you see Centaur as well as Batrunner up here at the top lane. Batrunner's kind of scouting out around the trees over here, burning everything down in his way, trying to see if anyone's hiding along there. But as we see, that's not the case. So instead, Centaur will just keep things going forward. Has that Abyssal Blade himself, another 4,000 gold saved up. He's not with his team currently, although, okay, here we go, the Smoke of the Sea coming out. And now they're moving around. They want to get a pick before they go in, I guess is the plan here. I mean, Slark does not have a buyback currently. Neither does Viper, though, at this point.
Yeah, Slark needs to be really, really careful about not getting lassoed again. And the problem, too, with their lineup is they have no way to save them. Like, their Shadow Demon, as we saw, was banned out first by ATN, so that you can't use that. There's no swap from Venge. There's nothing to stop them. I mean, maybe you X Slark in hopes that then they go for the last one, you can bring him back, but that's just wonky. It will never happen.
Yeah. And you cannot Yul's Scepter your teammates, unfortunately.
Oh, thank God for that.
That is not a thing. You're happy for that? Are you?
We only asked for 3 years to get that changed. We only asked for 3 years.
I mean, all right. I like it, man. It feels good.
Feels good.
Makes
man.
Me feel better saving teammates. But yeah, you cannot do that here. So yeah, but there really isn't anything, right, as far as items go, that are like, I'm going to save my teammate item.
Lotus Orb is the best, but you can't do it after the fact. After the fact of lasso, you can apply it before, and then he lassos himself and sits there.
Okay.
It's kind of funny, but yeah, in terms of items, there's really nothing. You can't Force Staff, you can't Lotus Orb after. The best you can do is try to prevent extra damage with like mech, pipe,
true.
Things like that.
Glimmer Cape, that's what's being brought up, I guess.
Glimmer Cape is okay, but at this stage of the game, they're going to have vision of you.
Yeah.
They do have a gem on the Elder Titan, so.
Well, they're knocking on the door now. Again, buyback situation still remains the same, although it's getting close for both Slark as well as Viper, having enough gold for it. I also saw, Center actually sent in a, he had happened to get a couple of illusions. He sent them in. I mean, the illusions were doing so much, and they're difficult to kill even. Kind of lucky that they don't have an illusion-based hero with them even, but something was coming out too, I think. Oh, that's actually a Chrysalis purchased by Centaur. It's in a stash right here, so.
Huh. Yeah. He should probably go for the newer item, the Bloodthorn, instead of the Daedalus. It's insane amounts of damage and very, very low cooldown on the effect.
Jeez.
It's 11-second cooldown, whereas Orchid is normally, like, I think 16 or something.
5-second silence. 18. Jeez. And amps of damage. Yeah, that's
just
basically really good.
Yeah, it's just a buffed up Orchid, basically, yeah. With a very, very low cooldown. People don't realize that aspect of it, but being able to cast that thing over and over with a 5-second downtime is pretty, or 6-second downtime is pretty insane.
Wow, yeah, it's only 11-second cooldown. Holy crap.
Yeah, very, very low. Goes down from 18.
Why do we not see that item yet? Wow.
It's the most expensive item.
It is expensive. That kind of makes sense.
It costs a lot more than Divine Rapier.
Yeah, that is kind of weird. All right, fair enough. Batrider flying around on the front. I take it they can still see the fire. Even, oh, there's a lasso. They do catch Focus. Oh, no. Focus in trouble. He does have a buyback, so he's going to use it probably right away. There we go. So he uses the buyback, and immediately ATN is going to start falling back.
That was a wasted glyph, though. But anyway, As Potom is trying to pursue, there is an egg down. I don't think he can kill this all by himself. It's a lot of attacks.
Yeah, he's like, all right, I'm getting out of here. Not going to happen. He leaps away. Slark, meanwhile, catches Viper in the back. Sunray's being used, but Slark with that BKB now. There's a vacuum into the wall. Pretty good one at that. And now Viper's trying to run. He got pulled back in, though. Viper is going to fall right there, so he is dead for sure. Centaur, can he port out? Yes, he can. Elder Titan was also picked off throughout it. Their chase kind of continues. As never mind, Phoenix will be out, and that will be the end.
The timing of that Aegis despawning was just very fortuitous there for Broodmothers.
Oh, true.
It went right as they were going on the Viper, and then he died. So he does have buyback, and that's okay. But he doesn't really do much in these fights when he's focused. I will say, for the whole idea that Slark is not getting these dark packs off when he needs to for the lassos is, yeah, that's obviously bad. But his BKB timing is very, very good in these fights. He's using it right. Oh. Just as I was talking about that, he gets taken out. Oh, that was kind of a stacked Abyssal Blade there. Let's see if he can get off that ulti. No, we cannot. That's 125 seconds of no buyback. And as you see, Elder Titan recognizes that, buys back right away. And they want to end this game right now.
That's probably it. I mean, without Slark, they just do not have the damage. There's no way. So it comes down to that. Getting picked off there in the middle. And here comes the charge. You mentioned the buyback happens. So 20 seconds for Viper to be up. Centaur is just like, come at me, bro. As he's literally just standing here now. So I guess just out of range of the towers. But yeah, I want to maybe wait for Viper to be really safe. But Centaur's just going up in the front lines as Mirana jumped back here.
Look at those towers just destroy themselves.
Wow. So much strength. He has a Chrysalis as well, so he's even hitting fairly hard now on top of that. Going to go right for Mirana, actually. Puts out some auto attacks. The ship comes through, but that Sunray. Okay, Mirana uses the cheese, actually, to survive for the time being. Darkseer, though, in the background, he's dealing with a... It looks like, oh, yeah, the Viper did pour it in. Mirana gets taken out. The egg going to go off right there from Phoenix. And now Darkseer is going to fall as soon as the focus goes on him. He buys back, but I think the end is here. The buyback's just not going to be enough, most likely. The lasso happens on to Mirana, pulls her away. Elder Titan throws out that ultimate. Being the Earth Splitter, and now they're focusing on the Radiance Ancients. Oh, kinda. Viper's actually getting pretty low right here. Okay, well, Viper's gonna die. Well, maybe I underestimated.
Well, Centaur buys back. Viper has no buyback. If they're able to hold off a little bit for 29 more seconds until Slark is back, really, really good stomp right there from the Elder Titan. Gets a two-man. Kunk is forced to buy back. This Potom doesn't have one, though. Okay, Potom's gonna be okay.
Oh my gosh, that was a huge slam. I think it even hit three, actually. Now, Centaur Warrior, again, he's doing plenty of damage. Darkseer getting very low right here. Not enough, though. He will be able to get out with the Forest Staff, and now Centaur is going to pop the BKB and start running away. So they cannot actually finish yet. All those buybacks taking place. You see on the left side of the screen right there. And we've seen before, you know, as long as this game is still happening, I mean, this is definitely still winnable for PM with that Slark.
Those were some amazing stomps, though, by Elder Titan. I thought they were just going to, like, stomp them, let them sleep there for, what is it, 4 or 5 seconds? 5 seconds and just hit the throne. they woke him up and tried to go for kills, but ended up just too much damage. They were predicting that they couldn't do as much without their Slark, but... This Potom is doing a ton of damage with the fresh BKB that she bought after she bought back. The Kunkka is just keeping them, like, annoyed, like, just with tons of X's and Torrents and Yules and all that jazz. And then, so now with the Slark being up, if he's able to finally save up for buyback, actually he doesn't have it for another 3.5 minutes. Mm-hmm. So he's got to be very careful still.
Yep, now that's, you look at the cross again, everyone really, the no buyback's popping up. Right now Phoenix, the only one with one. Has the gold appropriate for it. But something else too, Yukunka actually having that Chrysalis here, actually another 2,000 gold saved up, so even the Daedalus could be coming out for him, and that's some decent damage that could be assisting in these fights as well as we pick things up here in this game. But again, they're still in it. Can't say I expected this one, especially after the first game, man. I know you didn't get to cast that one as well, but it was a stomp. BM just rolled over ATN. It was like 22-2 at the end, I think, or something like that. So, but I guess that's why you never let one game kind of judge how a team is. So, ATN
sometimes
fought back.
Sometimes it's just a missed draft, and you can tell from the get-go that the drafts were just not equal, and yeah, something happened in the laning stage that was just disastrous.
What is your take on Troll Warlord? That was a funky pick, it felt like, from BN. Or actually, ATN picked up that up the first game.
It doesn't ever get picked up anymore. Relatively weak, I'd say, when you compare it to other carries. It does have its place, though. When you certainly still pair heroes like Void with him, and you initiate with the Void and then pop the Troll ulti, certainly very good in those kind of games. I think in games where you utilize the ulti, Troll is still pretty powerful. I will say that Troll is a very, very good laner. Like, if you lane something like a Crystal Maiden plus a Troll in the safe lane, like, no offlaner is going to get anything in that lane. It's just very difficult to deal with the axes and the slow from someone like a Crystal Maiden or any other kind of support. But in terms of just putting him up against, like, say, like a Morphling, it's just not even close.
Yeah. Yeah, and actually that last game, they actually didn't even have anyone contesting it. So I did get free farm, and it was, but unfortunately we never got to really see it take off because his team around him, unfortunately, was getting crushed. And by the time he was actually pretty solid farm, the game was basically over. So perhaps in the future, one can dream. See the farmed and effective Troll Warlord. But again, ATN, completely different game this game around. They may not have the hero kill lead, but they definitely have had a solid lead of sorts throughout most of this game, and we thought the game would be over with that push that we just had right there, but it actually was held off from Broodmothers here. So we do continue. Slark gets it another chance. You mentioned, though, he does not have a buyback for another 2 minutes here. Is Roshan up? No, not up just yet. Coming up soon here, though. Another minute 30, it looks like. Did you cue that or something, or did that just pop out after I said that?
No, it just happens.
Okay.
So it's just really nice timing.
Yeah. Makes me look good, I guess. This Elder Titan gonna harass the middle right here. How far does this image go? Can you just go, like, to whatever? The Elder Titan image?
Until the duration ends. Well, let's see what it is. Like,
8 seconds.
Eight seconds. So so the faster your movement speed, the faster your spirit's gonna move. So, so he does have Tranquils on right now. Plus his Yules, plus the smoke that just pops makes you 15% faster. So, but normally he's sitting around 450 movement speed, and it's always good to have extra movement speed on Elder Titan so that your spirit's not like a super slow thing running around.
Seems like that stomp is already hard enough to get off. So, yeah, the speed helps with that Echo Stomp though. Yeah, 6 seconds or 5 seconds done even, but
there was a period of time when Elder Titan was being picked up as like a three position, and people would go Saint and Yasha on him.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
But that time is long gone. Here we go.
Yeah, Batrider going in. No, can't catch him though. He has to kind of reset right here. Slark is seen pouncing away actually, so they kind of ran right through each other. And instead, no initiation happens on the arrow. Okay, it's going to be dodged. Marana still charging, though, and so is the Slark. They want to catch somebody. Phoenix is almost going to sacrifice himself or says, go after me, please. Now they're going to go after Elder Titan, so still not necessarily the worst target in the world. But Elder Titan is going to be picked off, and that's a gem as well, actually.
And that gem really should have been on the Batrider. Had that gem been on the Bat, they could have done something there with the Slark just running in. You saw Slark get scared, and I think it's because he had assumed, Phoenix was caught down there. I was looking somewhere else, but I didn't assume that he would get caught too. But you saw that Slark just kind of like assumed Bat was seeing him, and he got kind of spooked and freaked out, rightfully so, because he needs to be safe. He doesn't have a buyback, so the Bat really should have had the gem, not the Elder Titan. The Elder Titan's the one, like, probably the furthest away, I would say, out of all the heroes. Now that he drops the gem, did they have another one in stock? They might have another one in stock, and I really think it's important that Bat buys that and gets that on him. I know he's got gold. He has a Shadow Blade, actually. I'm probably going to go for a refresher here with that Perseverance, but that's something you can kind of throw in the stash if you really need to. I don't think he necessarily needs the Lothar's, but...
Yeah. Oh, Viper turns around and actually throws the Viper Strike onto the Slark right there. The Sunray coming out as well. Darkseer caught in the midst of that. He's going to be fine for now, but now Slark putting in the auto-attacks, catches Batrider, and Batrider will go down. Slark feeling comfy now that Batrider is dead, and he ain't buying back this time. So now it is BM's turn to charge. Are you kidding me? There's some way somehow doing this comeback here for real. The Centaur, not much he can do right now, having to deal with the Slark, and adding up those charges really is all that's doing. And actually, Centaur is feeling the pain there. Has to run back to the well, start to get some region on, but this top racks, it's going to be destroyed. Vulnerability is used here by ATM, but again, Batrider's still 85 seconds. Oh, the stomp hits, but he got the dark backed off, and he goes towards the middle now. So can they hold right here without the Batrider initiation? That's what it comes down to.
Well, these constant illuminate spams from Keeper of the Light 2 are really keeping them in fighting shape as it heals them for like 500 damage. It's very, very strong, and Slark naturally heals himself anyway, putting some more damage and pressure on the Centaur, getting those stacks up. He has a BKB active, and I think that's going to be a dead Centaur.
All right, is it actually going to be a dead Centaur? Wow, they finally kill the raid boss there.
No buyback.
And no buyback indeed. In fact, the Tauren combo also hits on Viper, and Viper doesn't have a buyback. And that, okay, he did. Never mind. He bought back right away. I saw the no there, but he did it instantly. So
maybe
okay.
It just came up or something.
Yeah.
But regardless, I don't think that he's going to be enough to defend all of this. All five members of Broodmothers. Slark even has a buyback now finally available with Boots of Travel if he dies.
Oh, man.
39 stacks of Essence Shift that's pumping up his agility by 117. I think they actually did it. I think this game is probably over here in favor of Broodmothers.
I can't believe that.
ATM's got to be beating himself up.
Yeah, that's got to be so frustrating. I mean, they had the two racks killed in, what, like 30 minutes, if not even earlier?
Maybe less, yeah.
That was ridiculous. And the comments you were making then was that Slark maybe wasn't reacting in time with the Dark Pact. And, you know, not that it's easy, but at this level, you'd almost expect it. However, then he started doing that and won a couple fights top lane. And before you know it, they're coming back now. ATN had a chance with the no buybacks on Slark, but still not enough. And again, this game's not over just yet, though, so I don't want to get too ahead of myself. Although Viper is killed, and this time he does not have a buyback. 100% certain on that one. Mirana's feeling the pain from the Centaur War Runner here, and actually is going to fall despite trying to leap away at the last second. So Centaur doing a good job with that damage. Slark did die as well and forced a buyback. This game is just doesn't want to end, Tralf. I don't know. 68 minutes in now. Neither team truly wants to win.
We got super creeps versus some mega creeps.
Oh boy.
So semi douchey guy versus super or mega douchey guy. And obviously the more douche, the stronger you are in this context.
All right.
And they're just going to go for it. They buy back. They recognize Viper's got no buyback. They're way stronger. They got a numbers advantage. They got the creep advantage. And here we go.
Oh, they're working on the tier fours now. And they're going to die shortly after this. So again, with Viper dead for 60 seconds. I mean, I thought that it was over earlier in ATN's favor, so I'm going to hold off on judgment on that. But okay, there's the pull onto Slark. He does get out with the Dark Pack, though. There was Ship coming in as well. And Phoenix is already picked off. Slark seems like he's standing his ground pretty well. Actually, he's getting somewhat low. Centaur doing some good damage, and he gets the kill onto... that was Darkseer, never mind. Slark is up here, actually, getting away. Currently with that silver edge of his, but he is fairly low on life, so he does need to be careful. He opens onto Centaur, and all of a sudden he starts healing back up, and down goes Centaur, and everyone is dead, and that actually will do it. Finally, in fact, disconnects already happening. BM will take out ATN here in game two, and thus take the series also 2-0 in this group stage matchup. Wow.
Do you have the same thing I have? So, like, when you view it in ticket like this, the default chat is like party. So every time that they start leaving, I'm like, geez, they must be really upset. No one's saying GG. But then I'm like, wait, no, I'm just on the wrong tab. And if you actually go to like the game tab, then you see all the GGs. I'm like, okay.
It must have been
like,
on
everyone's
that then.
Just bad mood or something, but.
I guess they were GG then. Okay, yeah, because people in chat are saying that too. It's like, oh, rage quit. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't have that up. That was my fault then.
No, it's just the default, I think. But it happened to me too. But yeah, no, it that was just a case of, you know, not respecting the late game of a team that has much better late game than you. And it really was one specific fight where it turned around. And it's when they already had two sets of racks advantage for ATN. They went for the top push, and every single time leading up to that point, it was a solo Slark going around for a backline kill, which is the right idea. He just got caught every single time. This time, I think that they were smoked or potamulted and they didn't have vision down, and it was the entire team, and they went around behind them as the ATM was going for the last set of racks, and that was just the beginning of the end.
I did not expect to cast a 70-minute match. I'll say that, too, especially, again, after the game won the way it went, but wow, yeah, BM somehow comes back and wins that, and Hey, it was fun though. It was fun to get that cast in there. So, hopefully, you guys tuning in also enjoyed that one. Again, BM, they do take it 2-0, and I'm not exactly sure how the format of this event works in terms of everyone moves on, just matter if they're the losers or winners or whatever. But that does put ATN at 0-0-2, I guess you would call it here. Again, they lost to Vega earlier as well. So, it looks like actually only the top team from each.